Alright. So I don't know about you, but I hate calling tech support. How many of you hate calling tech support? Like for anything. I mean, I don't care whether it's my computer, I don't care whether it's an appliance in my house, I hate calling tech support. I would rather gnaw off one of my arms than to have to pick up that phone and dial all those numbers that they put you through. You know, dial 1 for this and dial 7 for that, and I never know what number to dial because I don't even know what's wrong in the first place. So how do I know what to dial? And whenever you call, the person on the other end of the line sounds so young, they probably sound about, what, 15, 16, fresh out of college. So immediately, as soon as they ask, what's the problem? I start laughing, exactly. I start laughing and I'm like, I'm so tempted to say, well, I'm trying to roast a turkey, but you know, I've lost the directions or something, you know, but I know they're not gonna laugh about that because they're very serious and they take their job very seriously. And then you begin to explain the problem, and the moment that you start spitting it out, or at least with me, I feel kind of stupid. They start talking all these techie terms, all this computer jargon, and I feel like a foreigner in this world that I've never existed in. And so I ask a lot of questions. I ask what, and I ask where, like where do you want me to put this, and how is this supposed to look? I ask, what is an ADSL? Wilma might know what an ADSL is. I have no clue what that is. And I don't know the difference between firmware or software either, so I feel kind of stupid when I'm on the other end. But, you know, I learn best when somebody shows me what to do, right? So when they started making this newfangled thing where they can dial into your computer and they can take control of your cursor and do the things for you, I'm like, yes, exactly. I'm like, yes, because then I can actually see what is going on. You know, thank goodness that God sent his son to not only tell us what to do, but to teach us those tools. Jesus came to be our ultimate techie. Amen. So before we dial that support number tonight, I want to bow our heads and let's pray. Gracious Lord, Lord, I just thank you so much for this opportunity that I'm being able to have to stand up before your people and to speak your word. Father, as I look out into this crowd tonight, I see so many faces that are so loving and supportive of me. So help me put my nerves at ease. But Father, most of all, let your Holy Spirit flow through me this evening. Let your words be implanted into my mouth and into my heart, Lord, so that those are the words that are delivered this evening, not my agenda. And it's in your mighty name I pray. Amen. So I love how this passage that Paul is delivering, it seems to be he's singing his confidence in God. I can sense his peace and his faith, and actually, I'm a little jealous and guilt-ridden because I wish that I felt this way at all times when I'm talking about God. But Paul knows that before Jesus came, there was no man who could ever really come close to God. The works of the law before the coming of Jesus was never enough. There was no sacrifice great enough to get us to God. And then God sent his son to save us. The one who would not just give, but that would teach us the tools in which we needed to solve problems, world problems, church problems, for us to find solutions. He came to show us that what grace looks like. And grace is one of those words that we hear often, just like that computer jargon, but we don't fully understand it. Amen. Grace is the love and mercy given to us by God, just because God wants to give it to us. It's just like a present that a parent gives a child. Grace is the love and mercy given to us, not because of anything we've done, but just because we haven't earned it. It's just because. But do we show that same beautiful grace to other people in our lives? I know that we don't sit there, we don't say, you know what, Krista, you don't deserve grace. But do we shun people? Do we turn our backs? Are we less likely to be inconvenienced when somebody needs something? Do we show love to others? You see, God's grace is that overflowing love he has for us. And I'm sure that some of you might have heard that term before, and my cup runneth over. I think about a teacup, a beautiful teacup with a saucer underneath it. And I think about the tea running out. What are we supposed to do with that stuff when it runs out.
Give it.
That's right. We're supposed to give it. We are supposed to give it away because grace abounds through those who allow themselves to see people through God's eyes,
Amen.
Not our own. Yes. I love John Wesley. I am a Wesleyan. I'm a girl after Wesley. John Wesley, our forefather of Methodism, he understood grace. He understood it in three equal parts. He understood prevenient grace. And it's easily described as that wooing grace. I love that word, wooing grace. This is a time of courtship between us and God. God reaches out to us, and he begins to call us by name. He calls Trish, and he calls Loma, and he calls Janine, and he even calls you, Barry. And he draws us in. I knew I'd get a smile out of him. And he draws us in so that we can see that relationship with him is what we were created for. That is our purpose in life. I don't know about you, but there have been times I've asked, God, what is my purpose? And he says, to love me, to be in relationship with me. And we are wooed from conception. From the time that our atoms split, we are being wooed by God, even before then, but I don't even know what that's called. So it's before our conception. Many enter this life with a sense of who God is. Some of us were taken to church at an early age. We just knew. We can't think of a time that we didn't know God. But myself, I hit my head a few times. And I turned off my heart at times. And I chose not to answer. But in his letter to the Roman Christians, Paul wrote, "But God proves his love for us in that while we were still yet sinners, Christ died for us." And that's a key word there, while. He didn't say when we became pure and holy, then he would send Christ. He said while. And this verse demonstrates the justifying grace of God. It points to reconciliation and pardon and restoration. Through the work of God in Christ, our sins are forgiven. They are completely washed out, and our relationship with God is restored. According to John Wesley, our image of God becomes distorted by our own sin, but it's renewed within us through that death of Christ. God's grace alone brings us into that relationship with God. Amen?
Amen.
All right. There's no hoops through which we have to jump in order to please God or to be loved by God. We need only to respond in faith. Our response to that gift, that's the action. We should be constantly transforming. And this process involves a change within us. So we have to do something. We have to stop making excuses. And we have to stop setting fires in our own homes. Because, you know, that's not what God wants for us. He wants us to turn around. As Pastor Michael says in the past, you know, it's that GPS. Turn around, dummy. Turn around, you know. You're going the wrong way. So we have to turn ourselves around. And for some of us, that may be sudden. For others of us, it's a very dramatic thing. And yet, there are people like me that it's very fragile. But no matter what, it's a new beginning. Justification. It's what happens when Christians abandon all those vain attempts to justify themselves before God. To be seen as just in God's eyes. It's that time of pardon. It's that time of forgiveness. And I keep repeating that because that's exactly what we're working towards. A new peace and joy and love. We're justified by God's grace through faith, but justification is also a time of repentance. And we don't like that word, do we? We don't like that word of repentance. It means we need to get on our knees and we need to give it all to God. It's a time of turning away from those behaviors rooted in sin. You know, we say in recovery that it's our sole reliance on our own understanding. Notice our own. That got us into the messes we faced.
Yes.
But after, after we made that decision to call on Jesus, that's when we need to begin to ask for his will to be done in our lives, not our own. I like what Krista sometimes says, that's when the real work begins. That's when the healing begins.
Amen.
So to truly repent, we must not only turn away from that sin, but we have to turn towards God. You can't do one without the other. Repentance allows you to go forth. You know, I have to tell this story. When I was a child, my father was a single parent. And, you know, it's hard to say, but we were downright poor. I was always careful what I asked for birthdays or for Christmas, because I didn't want to ask for anything too big, because I didn't want to hurt my father's feelings. I knew my father would go to the ends of the world in order to be able to provide what it was that I wanted. And I never wanted him to feel bad. But for my 12th birthday, my dad bought me a gold watch. It was, I think, 10 karat gold. It was very thin band, I remember, and it had a little small clasp. But I remember feeling so grown up. I remember when I wore it to school, I had this pride about me. For some reason, and this is another sermon for another day, but for some reason, it washed away my feeling of being not good enough. It washed away my feeling of being too poor. But one afternoon as I walked home from the bus, I clearly remember this, and to this day, I can still see what I was wearing. I was walking home from the bus stop, and I just happened to be kicking the gravel, and I looked down, my watch was gone. I didn't know whether to turn back and go this way and go look for it, or go this way and run home and cry. But I chose to go home, because I was a latchkey kid and I still had a few hours that I could come up with some excuse as to where my watch was. But as it happens, when I got home, the situation only got worse. I wasn't allowed to talk to boys at this point in my life. Now, I don't know, you know, that sounds a little far-fetched to me. I don't ever remember being told I couldn't talk to boys at school, but I always even felt like I was being secretive doing that. So, you know, in my house, there was a rule, no boys for me.
Amen.
But I was also forbidden to answer the telephone, because somebody at 12 years old might know that I was a latchkey kid and that I was home alone. And, you know, that was during the whole phase of stranger danger, which we still have, but it was really played out in home, stranger danger. Mm-hmm. So when I got home, the phone was ringing. And we had caller ID, but I didn't recognize the number, but I still couldn't pick it up even if I did, unless it was my dad. And the machine picked up, or answering machine picked up. And as the call came through, it was this young boy who I was in class with, who had gotten hold of my phone number and was leaving me a message. And so that night, not only was I fretting about my watch, but I was also fretting about this, you know, call on the answering machine. And so at first my dad didn't answer it the first night, and I was like, phew. And then the next day I got this crazy idea to cover up that mess too. So not only was I ready to make excuses about my watch, but I'm also making excuses about this answering machine. And so I rushed in right after school then, the very next day, and I changed the answering machine. I played it back and tried everything I could to erase that message. And so as I'm playing these messages, I'm realizing I'm going too far, and my dad's calls are also getting erased. So I stopped it. My dad comes home that night, and he looks to see if there were any calls on the machine, and the red light wasn't blinking. Y'all remember those red lights? They have to flash, and the red light's not blinking. And so we went about our evening, and I laid in bed that night, very, very sick to my stomach. Next night comes. We're on day three by now, and I remember this clear as day. We're on day three. By this time, I'm laying in bed the next night, and my dad is playing this machine, and I can hear it. Well, now I see what I've done. I've not only erased his messages, but I've pieced two messages together. I was in trouble. So I climbed out of bed because I just knew that my dad was going to begin to ask questions. And I climbed out of bed just guilt-ridden, and I cried. And I ran to him, and I fell into his arms, and I told him everything. I told him from the watch to the boys. I was guilt-ridden. The guilt was so strong. That's why I got up. It was my conscience that had taken over. I knew that I had done wrong, and I couldn't wait to get it off my chest. And at this point, I didn't even care what the consequences were. I just needed to repent. You know, repentance is not a one-time event in our lives.
Amen.
It's an ongoing experience of God's gracious presence in our lives. And justification is not a term that is used to try to cover up the crime or sin in which we have committed. It's that we, the offender, have been exempted from the penalty that that we so unjustly deserve. Our death sentence has been set aside. You know, my father, it had grounded me that night. And no doubt he was so disappointed and probably a little overwhelmed. I mean, here was his little girl. And honestly, up until that point, I really didn't cause any problems. I was a good kid. I did everything to please those around me. But my dad sent me to bed that night after I told him. And I laid awake that night wondering what my punishment would be. Would he take my Nintendo away? Oh my gosh, that would have been the end of my world. So I just knew that my life was coming to an end.
Nintendo.
Nintendo, Mario Brothers, you know? But my dad came in a few moments later, and he sat down next to my bed. And he began to tell me a story about when he was a child. He got in trouble, and he told me about how his conscience bothered him too, so very badly, as he drifted off to sleep one night. He told me of how he got up and went and found his mom, and he confessed all to her without hesitation. She hugged him. He told me about forgiveness that night, that she forgave him. You see, my dad at this point in his life, as a parent, was not a born-again Christian yet. He believed in God, but he had not come to know Jesus as the one who was sacrificed for him. But he did understand grace. And he understood love, and he understood faith. You know, what we have faith in shapes who we are.
That's right. Amen.
My faith in God as a child was shaped by those lessons from my earthly father, those that he taught me. He showed me love and understanding, even when I made decisions that were totally wrong and despicable in the eyes of the world. He taught me that God loves me this much. My understanding and my faith, as it matured, I came to understand why Jesus came. I understand that God didn't wait for me to be sinless, yet he did this in hopes that I would become sinless. Through God's grace, we grow and we mature in our ability to live as Jesus lived. As we pray, we study the scriptures, and we fast, and we worship, and we share in fellowship with other Christians, we deepen our knowledge and love for God. As we respond with compassion to human need, Skylar and Dave, Gary and Sharon, many others in here, we strengthen our capacity to love neighbor.
Amen.
Jesus taught us through his words and his actions, and he taught us how to love one another despite our shortcomings. He speaks to us through his parables about this. He is the ultimate techie. Jesus shows us the process in which we need to go through in order to reach what Wesley calls the ultimate holiness, that sanctification. And it's not that Wesley meant that we were going to be perfect. He knew we would still make mistakes and have weaknesses. He himself had made mistakes, and he had weaknesses. Rather, he understood it to be a continual process of being made perfect in our love of God. Each other. You know, we should always strive to be holy. And I ask myself, what are some ways that I can do that? So here are some practical ways that we can do this. We can first be believers who desire to live fruitful lives. We have to form our faith. What do we believe in? We have to be willing to set aside our own earthly desires and follow the example that God has given us through his Son. But then we need to act on that faith. We need to be dead to sin. We need to call upon Jesus, our technical support, and familiarize ourselves with his words and defrag our lives to match what he asks us. Stepping out in faith and relying on his direction to carry us through. You know, the results may not be what we expect them to be. We may be rich one day, and when we pick up our cross, we may be poor. But you know what? When we call on the expert, the outcome is far greater than we could ever imagine.